Sabbath where I was in Arkansas, and 10 days before, this date, November 9th, had been suggested as a close of probation for the priest. So that's, you know, obviously something that most of us are familiar with in detail. And this date had been predicted based upon 126 days from the camp meeting in Arkansas or in Italy. And it was on July 27th that that prediction was made. And I was here on October 13th at noon, and I made a calculation that from October 13th, 2018 to November 9th was 391 and a half days. Now, we had something happen in that move, in this movement from this period to this time, as there was an apostasy that occurred. And it was on September 7th that Elder Jeff spoke, and I was now not in Arkansas, I was in Warburg, and I was doing a calculation, and that calculation showed me that this was 63 days before November 9th, and September 7th is the ninth month times the seventh day, 9 times 7 is 63. But more than that, I could look back here at this period of time and figure out the number of the days. And I'm not going to give you all the numbers, but what I found is that the date that was in the center of this was March 27th, 2019. Okay, so any questions on this part before I move on? Does everybody understand this, or does somebody have questions about this history? Everybody understands this fully? So this March 27th, 2019. Yep, somebody has a question. Bonnie?
I just want to comment that my head is spinning. If you could maybe post all this, because I can't even see what you're putting on the board there.
Okay.
I'm listening to you, but it's really not much of it is going in.
Okay. You don't remember it all. You do remember that October 13th is where we start the midnight cry, correct? For the priests.
Yes, I do remember that.
And you know that Jeff, on September 7th, he woke up, right?
Yes.
And
he came out of retirement.
Yes. And the center of this chiasm is March 27th. So halfway between October 13th and September 7th is March 27th. So this date becomes symbolic, because our message is about a message to the Seventh-day Adventist Church, to the Levites. And this becomes a symbol of the message to the Levites that we have, that we see in the 777 days from November 9th to December 25th. And we have these three Sabbaths. We have a Sabbath here, a Sabbath here, and a Sabbath here, which are our three way marks. This is different ways we look at it, but this is the beginning of Raphia. This is the beginning of Panium. We can look at it, you know, this is the end of Raphia. This is the end of Panium, however we want to look at it. And put this 13 days here, just underneath. Yeah, I know some people can't see it because their screens are small. But March 27th, 2019 is important, and March 27th, 2021 is important. And the number of days between these two events is 731 days. And the center of that is March 27th, 2020. So yesterday was the center of this period of time. Between this March 27th and this March 27th, right? So we have March 27th, 2019. Obviously, March 27th, 2020 is the center. And so we're the center of these two March 27ths. And my understanding is that we have a number of messages that we are giving that are part of the Midnight Cry. And one of those messages has to do with the tidings out of the east, which is Islam. And then we also have message with the tidings out of the north, which has to do with the papacy. But we also have the fact that there is another symbol that Tess presented, which was Acts 27 and Numbers 23, where we get this number 273 to represent the Levites. And the message that we have to give the Levites is the tidings out of the east and the tidings out of the north. So we have all these symbols, and I know there's lots of them, but I just want to focus upon this March 27th, what I think it means,
Theodore,
as far as in the context of what message we're going to be given, is that I believe that this has opened up the door, this pandemic has opened up the door to give the message to the Levites. And it's odd because the Levites are Seventh-day Adventists, and Seventh-day Adventists, well, we can't go to Seventh-day Adventist churches right now because they don't go to them. Nobody can go to church. And yet we have to give a message to them. And so we have a means of giving this message, which we're using right now. And of course, people are reading my articles and we're putting up a website. And so I believe that this is marking the time in which we're given an opportunity for people who are, one is they're questioning what's happening, and they're going to be looking at videos, and they're going to be reading papers. And so this is how God has given us this opportunity. Does that make sense to people?
I have a question.
Yes, Kate, Larry.
The March 27th, to get that to be the center, did you take into consideration the leap year this year?
Yes. Yeah. Yes, of course.
That would change the days, right? It wouldn't be the center if we have an extra day this year or the next year or whatever.
Yes. Yeah, it's... Now, the question about that is actually has to do with if you go to this chiasm from noon October 13th to noon September 7th is noon March 27th, 2019. When I take the 371 days, this brings me to the beginning of March 27th at midnight.
Okay.
So yes, I always take into account all those types of things. Believe me. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. So it was taken into account. So this is the start of March 27th, 2020 was exactly halfway between March 27th noon and March 27th here noon. So otherwise, you know, we'd have 730 days. So, okay. Any other questions regarding this? Because I think this is significant that we have. Now, from a personal point of view, being laid off from my work has given me now time, because I've been working lots, gives me time to finish the articles and the website, which has been getting up slower than we wanted it to get up. So that website is, I think, really important. So from a personal point of view, it's now okay. Now I got freed up another 40 hours that I can use and working on these things. Okay, any other questions before I get into the third part of my presentation? Okay, so I'm going to erase this now. Now, I've been trying to figure out the simplest way to present July 18th, 2020. The simplest way to understand how we got here. And to do this, it may seem a little bit odd, but I'm going to first go to Ezekiel, and I'm not going to deal with all the details in Ezekiel because there's way too many details to present. But I will present something that people can understand, I think, quite well. Now, in Ezekiel, he's going to have a vision on the fifth day of the fourth month, which is July 21st. 592 BC. So anybody who's writing that down, if you're drawing a line and writing it down and you can't read this, you can ask a question. But July 21st, 592 BC is Ezekiel 1:1. And Ezekiel starts in the fifth year of Jehoiachin's captivity. So this is going to be the fifth year. Now it's really, without getting into the details, I'll just write 5 here. This fifth year of Jehoiachin's captivity, we would probably call it the sixth year, but it's how he's counting. So I'm going to leave that off a little bit. So we just say it's 5 years. And he's actually referring back to the fact that Jehoiachin was taken captive in 597 BC. And this is in Leviticus 26. So if you go to Leviticus 26, which you're not going to do now, but if you read about the 4 7 times, the third 7 times addresses this siege of Jehoiachin. One of the things is it says that they shall measure your bread by weight. When Jehoiachin was taken captive by Nebuchadnezzar, he was taken captive and held for 36 years. And in 561 BC, he was released from captivity, and this was a period of 36 years. So he was held captive in the 37th year of his captivity. He was released. And this is in 561, at the beginning when Evil-Merodach began to reign, the beginning of his reign. We know the exact day that he was released and everything. So it's very, very interesting, this whole part of it. Now, when you read in Ezekiel's last vision is on October 22nd, 573 BC. So I guess I need to put this over here. Put it in the wrong spot. We'll put it over here. October 22nd, 573 BC. So obviously, this is 19 years. So none of this is in proportion. 19 years after his first vision. And this is on the 10th day of the 7th month. So I guess I'll put the 573. So this is an interesting fact about Ezekiel, is that this date from Millerite history, which is when Samuel Snow gave the midnight cry on July 21st, happens to be in this year on the Julian calendar, the same biblical date as Ezekiel had his first vision. And the last vision recorded in Ezekiel, which is Ezekiel 40 verse 1, is on the 10th day of the 7th month, in the 49th year of the biblical cycle. But it says it's in the 14th year since the city was smitten, referring to 586, and the 25th year of Jehoiachin's captivity. So there's a whole bunch of stuff dealing with that 25th year. The point that I want to make regarding this is that Ezekiel is illustrating Millerite history. So that's the simple way to look at it. Now, I want to take this out of here. So I put it in there. I'm going to take it out. So Ezekiel was illustrating Millerite history. And he was also illustrating the destruction of Jerusalem. And without getting into the details, we know that Jerusalem was destroyed in 586 BC on the 10th day of the 7th, or the 10th day of the 5th month. So this is Jerusalem's destruction. And Ezekiel has the prophecy in Ezekiel 4, where he lies on his left side for 390 days. And he ends at the midnight cry on August 15th. But he's also illustrating the 10th day of the 5th month and his third vision in Ezekiel 20, which is also on the 10th day of the 5th month. So I know I gave him a bunch of details I probably shouldn't have. But the point is that Ezekiel is illustrating the 10th day of the 5th month that Jerusalem is destroyed. But he's also referencing this to Jehoiachin's captivity. because he's always referencing things, or not always, but most of the time, he's referencing things in relationship to how long Jehoiachin has been captive. Now, this captivity here, if you take this captivity of Jehoiachin, and you see these 36 years, and we go over to the destruction of Jerusalem in 70 AD, in 70 AD, Jerusalem was also destroyed on the 10th day of the fifth month, just as it was in 586. Now, this is when I say Jerusalem, I'm really referring to the temple itself is destroyed here, and the temple is destroyed here. So there's a period of time, of course, in which the city is destroyed. But the actual date for the destruction of the Jerusalem is the 10th day of the fifth month in both of these histories. Now, Ezekiel is only predicting this date. He's only predicting the destruction of Jerusalem in 586. He's not in any way that when you look at it and you read it, you don't get any sense that he's talking about this destruction of Jerusalem in 70 AD. But yeah, he's referencing this period of time in Jehoiachin's captivity in relation to the destruction of Jerusalem. And when we look at the period of time from Jehoiachin's captivity to the destruction of Jerusalem here, the destruction of Jerusalem here occurs after what major event? So what happens? Why is Jerusalem destroyed?
It's 36 days after the stoning of Stephen.
So 36 years after the stoning of Stephen, in 34 AD, when probation is closed for the Jews, there's 36 years here. Now, 36 is a symbol, and it's a symbol of 666. Now, I don't know how many of you are familiar with the magic square. It's a Babylonian mysticism. They have a square where you have 6x6 squares, and they put numbers like 6x6 squares, and when you add them up, each line will equal 111, whether you're going up or down, right? So they'll have the numbers written in such a way that they'll add up to 111. And so if you add each of these rows, if they all equal 111, what does all the rows equal to? If you add them up, 6 rows times 111.
666.
Right, so you get 666. So this symbol is a symbol of Babylonian mysticism. Now, in Leviticus 26, it talks about this siege of Jerusalem in the third seven times. And in Deuteronomy 28, which is the sister chapter of Leviticus 26, it talks about this siege and destruction of Jerusalem in 70 AD. Now, we know that Rome has been passed down from Babylon, Media, Persia, Greece to Rome. This mysticism, Rome at that time, at the time of the destruction of Jerusalem, is involved in mystery cults, even though their official religion is ancestor worship. And so we know that Rome has inherited 666. And there's a lot more to it that I could show. But my point is, there's 36 years here at the beginning, and there's 36 years here at the end of a period of 666 years. So this 666 years from Leviticus 26, the third seven times, to Deuteronomy 28, Roman siege and destruction of Jerusalem, is not an accident. But it also shows something else. Ezekiel, even though he's only predicting this destruction of Jerusalem, he's also predicting this destruction of Jerusalem, the exact day in which it's going to occur. He's just not aware of it. I hope that that's clear. If it's not clear, if anybody wants me to repeat it, let me know if there's some questions regarding this.
I don't have a question with that, but is there any correlation with the 3.5 years between Cestius and Titus?
You mean in this history?
Yes.
No, not, well, the only thing I, there's a symbol of three, because Jehoiachin reigned for 3 months, 10 days, but no, there's not a period of years that's connected with that.
Theodore, could I ask a question, please? Yeah. On your little grid there, what are the numbers there that add up to 111? I can't quite see them.
Oh, I didn't write them in. They just write it so that they take the numbers 1 to 36. Like they might have 36 here and...
Oh, they can be all different.
Yeah, but, but there's only a few ways to arrange it. It's kind of like Sudoku, but you have to arrange it so that you spread the numbers out in a way that each row adds up to 111 going across, and each row adds up to 111 going down. I've actually done it once, but you'll see different magic squares that actually arrange the numbers differently. But
okay.
Not that much differently. It's mostly to just arrange the rows a little bit. I don't know how many possible ways it can be done. But good question. Anyone else? So just to sum this up, my point is that we have a prophecy in Ezekiel where he's predicting the destruction of Jerusalem, but we can also extend this prophecy over to 70 AD and see that he was predicting this as well, the very day this was going to happen. But it was not the intent of Ezekiel to do that. And we know that Ezekiel used the prophecy of Josiah as his basis to predict the destruction of Jerusalem, which I'm not going to go through right now. But the prophecy of Josiah, the 390 years and the 40 years, where he lays on his side for 390 days and 40 days, is where he gets this confirmation for when Jerusalem is going to be destroyed. So he's using the prophecy of Josiah. So I'm going to erase this now, and I'm going to deal with... And I'm not using this right now, even though I use this later to show what happens in 2020. I can show you that I can take this same principle and apply it to Josiah Litch's prophecy. So I know people are probably getting tired, but so just a simple thing. We know that in... Okay, I just got to plug in my laptop. Just hang on. Okay. Now, everybody following this so far? Any questions before I move on to Josiah Litch's prophecy? Okay. So we all know that Josiah Litch was using Revelation 9, starting at July 27th, 1299. He put up 5 months here, 150 years, and then he did an hour, a day, a month, and a year to have 360 years, 30 years, 1 year, and 15 days to come to August 11th, 1840. And that this is a period of 391.5 days. And we also know that in Ezekiel, there's 391.5 years from the start of his prophecy to the destruction of Jerusalem. So I'm not going to go into that right now. But this number here ties Ezekiel's prophecy with Josiah Litch's prophecy. The 391 years becomes significant. Now, we all know that Josiah Litch, he's looking for the prophecy to be fulfilled here. But the symbol that's used is the 26th day of the fourth month, which he didn't take into account. And so if anybody's unfamiliar with this, you can read my papers online, easy to find. If you write this, Theodore Turner, you'll find those papers. So we have this 26th day of the fourth month that's used throughout all this time. And it's from here, July 27th, that he counts 15 days to get to August 11th, 1840. So Josiah Litch is predicting an event here. But we know that this 15 days, if we just take off this 391, I said 391.5, but it's actually 391 years and 0.5 months. 15 days is a half of a month. And what we did, just in a simple way, is we looked for this symbol by taking 0.5 of a year. So how many in if I have in a day for a year prophecy, if I take 0.5 of a year, half a year, how many days is that?
180.
180 days. So this would be 180 years. And so we put 180 years here, or 6 months, just like we have 5 months over here. And we counted to the year 2020. Now, I had already picked, based on Ezekiel's prophecy, I'd already picked July 18th on the Julian calendar, which was July 31st, Gregorian. So that was from Ezekiel's prophecy. But I found that if I looked at the year 2020, and I looked at the 26th day of the fourth month, it was also July 18th, Julian, or Gregorian, pardon me. So I know this is rather complicated. The point that I want to make is that if we use the biblical dates, we can take Josiah Litch's prophecy and extend it into the future, to the year 2020, just in the same manner that Ezekiel's prophecy regarding the destruction of Jerusalem in 586 can also be applied to the destruction of Jerusalem in 70 AD. And there's a bunch of other tie-ins there. So when we deal with this date, July 18th, 2020, it comes from two different prophecies, and it doesn't result from any kind of coincidence of numbers in the sense of, you know, like 777 days. It comes from a biblical symbol, which we can establish in Ezekiel, that he uses the 10th day of the fifth month in a repeated pattern to show when Jerusalem would be destroyed, and that we can apply that repeated pattern of the 10th day of the fifth month and extend it to 70 AD. And we're doing exactly the same thing here. We're taking this symbol, which is mathematically impossible to have occurred randomly, in Josiah Litch's prophecy. So all these dates here are all July 27th. On either the Julian or the Gregorian calendar. As I said, there's a lot more to it here, a lot more detail. Any questions on this?
What's the last date where you're pointing at the top? July 31?
Yeah.
July 31.
And that's Gregorian?
Gregorian, yeah. And so we know in our history we have two July 31sts in the year 2020. One is the Julian, or July 18th, pardon me. One is the Julian July 18th, and one is the Gregorian July 18th. But this is July 31st. And there's 13 days between these dates in the Gregorian and the Julian calendar in our century and the last century. And this is a message here. The symbol here is the symbol for Islam, 26th day of the fourth month. from Revelation 9. The symbol here is the symbol for the church, the 10th day of the fifth month. Now, I want to go back to what I had done earlier dealing with March 27th. So to me, March 27th, the 27th day, the third month, symbolizes the message to the Levites. And we know that the March 27th that we just had is the center of a chiasm of March 27th that have both been marked out prophetically. And that number of days between the first and the last March 27th, with yesterday in the center of the chiasm, is a period of 731 days, which becomes a symbol of July 31st. And that's why I'm saying that I believe that our efforts from now on need to be focused upon giving a message to the Seventh-day Adventist Church. Now, we're doing a website where we're dealing with this, and the message is to be given to warn everyone, right? So not just Seventh-day Adventists. But it's Seventh-day Adventists who need to hear this message, because they need to know that the church that they're in was established on a solid foundation. And that's the thing that they don't fully understand. Many Adventists doubt Seventh-day Adventism. And what we're going to see happening here is quite interesting. Now, one of the things that happened yesterday, does anybody know the significance for yesterday in the Seventh-day Adventist Church? What happened yesterday for Seventh-day Adventists?
I don't know.
Well, a period of time to July 4th, 2020, is 100 days of prayer.
Start of the 100-day prayer.
Yeah, specifically relating to the COVID-19 pandemic. So Adventists have chosen this date, which is a symbol of 273, the Levites, to start a period of 100 days of prayer. And God is going to reach many of those people in this trying time with this message. Because those that are praying, who are sincerely seeking for light and trying to understand, God's going to reach them. And they will, at the end of that 100 days of prayer, they now have 2 weeks. Right? So there's 7 days and 7 days to July 18th, 2020. So hopefully the significance of this can kind of sink in. Any questions?
Theodore, just a quick comment. July 4th is where the GC was going to be ending.
Yes. Yeah, the general conference session was going to end there. Now, we also know that this is a symbol of what?
Independence
of the United States.
Symbol of the United States, right? So we have a bunch of symbols here. Now, Jeff presented in the Sabbath School this morning, or the Sabbath School comments. He dealt with the idea that we're not using numerology, that numerology and all these other systems are a counterfeit of the truth, that God uses numbers, but Satan also uses numbers. But there's a magical attribute that the numbers have in numerology, which we don't assign to numbers. We just see them as the wonderful number, the Palmoni, that Christ is helping us confirm what we have established by using line upon line, precept upon precept, here little and there little. We've used the proper method of studying the Bible. And so the fact that these numbers match up isn't telling us something new per se. It's just affirming what we've already established by other means. Okay.
Theodore, you said you were going to show how to give the July 18 message in a simple way. Was that what you have written here?
That's what I'm just trying to say. The simple way is to show that Ezekiel was predicting the destruction of Jerusalem in 586, mm-hmm. but he was also predicting the destruction of Jerusalem in 70 AD, even though he didn't know it. And that we can use Ezekiel's prophecy, or not Ezekiel's, Josiah Lynch's prophecy, and then we can show that he was predicting the fall of the Ottoman Empire, but he was also predicting Islam, the end of the third woe in our history, right? Because we know the first woe started on September 11, 2001. And, you know, so, I mean, I've presented a lot of stuff today, but if you want to present this message to Seventh-day Adventists, you have to establish this prophecy. Now, it requires a little bit of detail. So when I say simple, you know, it's simpler, maybe. But Seventh-day Adventists need to be familiar with this prophecy. And we do have a Seventh-day Adventist, Ron Dupree, who's actually been presenting pretty much this without the 26th day of the fourth month. He's been presenting the dates July 27th in connection with the hour, the day, the month, and the year. He hasn't been presenting the biblical dates. But if people can understand that Ellen White endorses this prophecy and that it's being rejected by Adventism, and they can get into a deeper study and see some of these details that we've missed, I think it's a simple step with the Holy Spirit working on the person's heart to recognize that this symbol, 26th day of the fourth month in our history, is not random. Now there's a lot more once you get the initial idea. What I always try to do is I always try, because our truths are based upon past light. And so what I always want to do is establish the past light, because no new light ever contradicts established light that God has revealed to his people. It always affirms it and strengthens it. And so always when I'm presenting something, whether it's the 2520 or this, I'm always going back and showing how the 2300 days is solid, that the 70 weeks is solid. Because without those, we wouldn't actually have any of this. Without Josiah Litch's prophecy, I would not have anything to base any predictions on. And, you know, we also understand here that we're not actually predicting any event connected with the second coming of Christ. We're not time setting in the way that Ellen White forbids. We're marking events in Islam. And they are tied to some degree to the bigger events, but we're not predicting, you know, the close of probation for the world, or the precise time of the loud cry or the latter rain, or the precise time of the second coming. We're just watching and waiting and recognizing the time that we are in. We are very close to a Sunday law. And so I think these symbols, this March 27th, 273, that shows up in our lines, that has been a part of our message for a couple of years, is the message. It is the message to give to Seventh-day Adventists. Is this message about what's coming? Because we know what we see happen. The fact that I can't work, or that we can't meet in a church, even though it's not directly related to a Sunday law per se, it has all of the characteristics of what they will do in regards to a Sunday law. They will restrict us from working. They will restrict us from meeting together. Even though all of us are being affected by it now, when the Sunday law comes, only those that are following God will be the ones that are affected by that Sunday law.
Theodore, could I ask a question just to clarify, please?
Yeah.
You mentioned Ron Dupree. You said he's a Seventh-day Adventist. Is he on the same wavelength, or is he varying?
Well, I've met with him in his home. He doesn't accept this message, if that's what you're asking. But yeah, he does accept this prophecy. And so you can show what he's done to Seventh-day Adventists. because he has some good work. There's also another guy, I can't think of his first name, but Treyer, who also is another scholar. So they're scholars, PhDs, who support Ellen White's understanding of Josiah Litch's prophecy. And we have way more detail than they do. But for somebody who maybe they're just introducing them to, you could first introduce them to Ron Dupree, maybe, you know, because it's a Seventh-day Adventist. And then they can see, if they can see that he's now fighting against this error within Adventism, then that might allow that person to be open to see more detail. So if you can add more detail to what Ron Dupree's doing, when the Holy Spirit's working on that person's heart, they're much more likely to accept it. But, you know, some people would just want to present it themselves. I'm just saying that if somebody's resistant to hearing you, they might listen to Ron Dupree first, and that might open the door for them to listen further.
Thank you.
And I just want to say Ron Dupree might be you never know what people might turn out to be, but he might be a Saul Paul.
Because, yeah,
he was the one that, you know, has been going around from the BRI, you know, showing why, you know, the different groups are in error. But you know what, by the same token, if you know him, he is a nice guy. You know, he's a very friendly, nice guy. He's not like Justice.
Yeah.
Oh, and Theodore, one of the things, if you can also mention, you know, where you can access your information, if you have different sites, what do they call, for people who might be looking, you know, if you can even write it down where they can access your, I think you have more than one place it can be.
Academia.edu has all my papers. That's the best place to go. You have to, you know, log in, but it doesn't cost anything. So you just have to create a username. It's really useful because I can actually analyze where people are reading my papers from all over the world and which universities they're attached to, if they're attached to a university. So, you know, for instance, yesterday, 70 of my papers were accessed on that site. And I've had up to, when I first put out my July 18, 2020 simple, I had, I think it was about 500 people within a couple of days access that paper on academia.edu. And I've had people from the Vatican access my papers. I don't know if that's good or bad. And also from Andrews University. So it allows me to see where in the world people are reading my papers. And, you know, some of you already are reading my papers, and I know because you're actually, I've been tracking you and watching you. Don and Bonnie's done that. And a lot of other people have read the papers on this site. So I can tell every time you download it or look at it.
How many of the July 27s up there correspond to a July 18?
At the beginning of this one here, this is July 18th, Julian. And this is July 27th, Gregorian. So this is in 1449. So that's the start of the 391 years. It's July 18th, Julian. And July 18th is a very powerful symbol in and of itself. The number 187, it's the number of days from the first day of the first month to the 10th day of the seventh month. There's lots of things about this number, but it showed up here as well. It's also the last of Samuel Snow's letters. So this symbol here that starts this, the very fact that it ends over here, I think is important. And that it also is both a Julian and a Gregorian date, because in Josiah Litch's prophecy, July 27th is either a Julian or Gregorian date. So does that help? Did you?
Yeah, that was my question, yeah.
Yes, okay, good.
How is Ron Dupree's last name spelled? It slipped my mind.
D-U-P-R-I-S, I think. Double E-S. Z. P-S.
Oh, no wonder.
Ron Dupree. Ron Dupree. D-U-P-R-E-Z.
Thanks.
Theodore, I know you're dealing with numbers here, but it's connecting with the coronavirus. Has there been any significance to the fact that you know of that, first of all, it started in China, and could that be the Red Dragon? And then it goes to the Beast in Italy, and then it goes to the False Prophet in the USA. Is there any connection there at all? Or am I just...
Well, I think that's probably some symbolism there that's probably valid. I never thought about it, but those are the three places that it really hit hardest so far.
Okay, just a thought. I just wondered. Okay.
In China, I've caught obviously the symbol of the red dragon, even though China in prophecy is mentioned very rarely.
Yeah, but it's to do with communism and paganism, isn't it?
Well, yeah, it's paganism, no doubt about that. Yeah. But it's not referred to very often. I think once in Ezekiel we have a reference, but maybe I'm even wrong about that. I think there's some dispute about whether China's ever mentioned. I can't remember the word they use for China.
It's interesting too, the beast and the false prophet, but we know the UN is the dragon.
Yeah.
But expect Europe to be hit as a whole, like they're going to be next.
Yes. Europe is definitely the next part that's being hit. And some people have commented, though, Europe's not doing that bad, but it's just a bit behind. You look at the numbers and you extrapolate them, they're going to be in the same shape as Italy in a couple of weeks. Even places like Germany, where people are saying, oh, they're not that bad. That's just because we don't understand exponential growth. We sort of tend to think in linear growth. So it's always a bit of a problem. Yeah. Spain is bad. Yeah, Spain is bad, which is part of Europe.
China is referred to as Sinar, Sinar.
Sidum.
Yeah.
C-I-T.
Isaiah 49:12.
That's it, yeah. That's the only place that I can think of where it's mentioned directly. Okay, any other questions? I don't know how late it is. I tend to get carried away.
It's 20 after, so you've got 10 or 15 minutes if you need it.
Okay. I don't know if I really need it. I can just kind of sum up a little bit. In trying to understand the purpose of this movement. So this is the thing that I've struggled with, and I know some of you have heard me talk about it, but this movement is typical. And we know that the things that have happened within this movement are not, like we had a close of probation November 9th. Well, that's not the close of probation, right? It affected some people, but it's just people within this movement. But it was typifying what's going to happen at the end of the world further on down the line. And, you know, and we've had a type of a Sunday law. We've had a midnight, right, which is the type of the Sunday law, and the midnight cry on October 13th. And we have seen all these internal events within our movement that we can actually see that they're part of prophecy. Jeff, on September 7th, me calculating at noon on October 13th and September 7th, doing these calculations. So we can see that we're all part of this prophecy, that this movement is typified by Ezekiel, and it's typified by Samuel Snow and others, right? So when we look at making a prediction on external events, I've always been rather reticent in doing so. I never set out to predict any events on July 18th or any dates, actually. I was never trying to predict a date. All I was doing was chronology and noticed things that suggested to my mind that there's something there. They weren't just random events. So in trying to understand this role, what I really believe is that this movement and the people within this movement are going through an experience that it's typifying what's going to happen. So even this pandemic, which is, we can put on our line as part of Panium in a sense, it's part of this period of time that we've marked in our history, which is here, this period of time back here. But we can see that it's, you know, this pandemic is typifying what's going to happen, you know, in some way. And then maybe this is more in the line of the Levites, if we wanted to look at it this way now, because Raphi and Panim are Midnight and the Midnight Cry in the line of the Levites. So in trying to get this, everything that I keep seeing, everything I keep reading in the Spirit of Prophecy always keeps pointing me to the fact that we have a message to give to Seventh-day Adventists and that we have to take this message seriously. And things may not turn out exactly the way that we imagine, but we still have to give the message because God has a purpose in this. I mean, we never saw this coming, right? So we're studying the Bible. I never saw this pandemic coming. It would have been nice if I had it. But I never did. I don't think any of us saw it in that way. I know Jeff referred to pandemics in connection with Panium and panic and panacea and Pandora's box and all these types of things back on January 14th, 2017, when he spoke in Alberta on the 13th to the 15th of January 2017. And I've been watching those presentations. And you can see that one of the things he talks about is a pandemic. But we never really seriously considered it beyond that. We just thought, well, the word pan is connected with, you know, Panium and all these other things. But now as we start to look back a little bit, we can see that this definitely is God's warning. You know, and one of the things I found interesting, I started looking at all the major pandemics that have occurred in the past. And one of the what's the biggest pandemic you can think of that's ever occurred?
The bubonic plague.
The Black Death, which happened in 1666, mm-hmm. Right?
666.
Yeah. And that on September 2nd, 1666, London burned to the ground in the midst of this pandemic, right? And that date is the 12th day of the sixth month, which is a symbol on the biblical calendar, is a symbol of 126 or the 2520. And this happens at a time when it's a warning to the British Empire, and they end up falling as time goes on within the next 110 years. You know, the United States is on the rise, right? And so we can see that these pandemics are warnings to nations and to God's people about things that are coming upon the earth. And I just started looking at this cursorily, and I noticed that I can actually go back in all these major pandemics and see that there's a connection between these pandemics and warnings of what's to come. Now, those are, you know, a little bit subjective, but when I see objective numbers like this, these are a little more, to me, tie these things in a little bit better, that, you know, it's not just a guess. And we know that this number 666, even though it's a number of paganism, it's a satanic number, and Islam also has 666 connected to it. So, because this has to do with the bottomless pit, the beast that comes out of a bottomless pit. And the bottomless pit is Satanism. And so that number, which Babylon has passed on to pagan Rome and then to papal Rome, is also a number of Islam. And so You know, there's a lot of these symbols here that are important. But the main thing is I believe that God's giving us a warning. And that warning allows us to give a message to others, right? So other people obviously are aware of this pandemic and are questioning what's coming on the earth. Seventh-day Adventists are going to be much more open to listening to a message regarding a Sunday law that's coming, right? But they also want to have things that are established on a solid basis. They don't want guesses. And I think that we have a message that has a lot of solid numbers connected to it, a lot of solid history, and solid biblical method of interpretation. That, and that's one thing, is we can't let the numbers sort of crowd out how we got to where we are, because we didn't use the numbers in, you know, counting the number of days and so on, and, you know, in our line to figure out, you know, where December 7th came from, these, or December 25th, or July 18th, or November 9th. We've actually used some really solid methods of biblical interpretation, and then we analyze them with numbers, and people think, oh, that's how you arrived at that. But no, it's not how we arrived at it. We arrived at it through line upon line, precept upon precept, here little and there little. So
yeah. On the 180 there, the 0.5, 180 in the 6 months.
Yeah.
I'm not remembering. How did we come to that being there?
391 years.
Oh, that's the 0.5. I got you.
5. So it's taking this 0.5 and now applying it to years. And then taking half of a year and making it 180 days,
okay,
it becomes 180. But there's actually other ways in which I also come to this date, and I did so using the Mayan calendar, which is a long story, but it actually shows spans of 273 days that actually end up pointing to the 10th day of the 7th month in 2020. So there's a whole bunch of other ways in which I've arrived at this history. A lot of it's very esoteric, so I don't think everybody's going to understand it, but I do have papers on it on the Academia site. And so people who are more inclined to look at those things, they can spend time reading them. But I do want to say that it, you know, we have simpler ways of doing things than I do them. But also, all that detail and all these numbers and all this chronology, without it, we wouldn't have seen the things that we've seen. But we can present it in a simpler way. I don't have to necessarily present everything that I know in order for somebody to understand it.
So this is Michelle. We've shown this to a friend before, and they argued that the 0.5 would be 15 days. Half of a month would be 15 days. So what do you say to somebody that argues that?
Yeah, well, we're just using the symbol of 0.5 and now applying it to prophetically. Yeah, obviously, this is not the first way I came to this date, right? So I came first through Ezekiel to get July 18th, 2020, before I even looked at how I would arrive at this here. But yeah, the 0.5 is 15 days, but we're taking 0.5 and we're superimposing Ezekiel's prophecy of 391 and a half years, right, which is based on the prophecy of Josiah. And this is the prophecy of Josiah Litch. And we're seeing that they're parallel to each other. And so if I can see the 391 in the period of Ezekiel's prophecy, then I can see that I can now superimpose Ezekiel's prophecy over top of this prophecy. Right? Yeah. People are going to argue, you know, but as things get serious, you know, if you spend time studying and praying, God will give you the right things to say to those individuals.
Right.
People that aren't interested or open to truth, God will never bring the right words to them, at least in my experience.
Yeah. Hey, Theodore,
yeah.
I think Larry might be taping the presentation today. Is there any way that it can be maybe posted or something like that?
Well, it can be posted on YouTube by anybody.
Okay, so maybe if Larry is taping it, he can probably post it, right?
I can share it with someone who could post it.
Okay.
But you can share it with me and I can post it.
Yeah, and I was going to ask you, Theodore, before I did anything with it. I just wanted to be able to go back over it.
Okay.
Right, because I think, you know, it was a great presentation that, you know, even for us going over it again and the fact that it could be posted, I think would be a benefit for a lot of people who will come upon it. And, you know, as I keep looking at your presentation, one of the things that stuck out in my mind that you, at first I was thinking, why would you mention Ron Dupree's name, eh? Because I know he was going from city to city or from church to church. But in one sense, it's reminding me of Paul that was going from, you know, city to city, you know, binding people, you know, and then the outcome of you know, Saul, Paul. And I think in some ways, I personally have talked to Ron Dupree, and in some ways I can see that about him because, you know, a guy from the BRI, he's not, you know, he would listen to you. He would
listen. Sanhedrin, or you know, he studied under Gamaliel.
Exactly. Right? You can see that. You can see that. So when you put it up at first, but I can see, you know, why you would send somebody to look, because I can see the Paul also, you know, the Saul-Paul relationship there.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I think he just does a good presentation on it. And Alberto Treye also does some very good papers. And we're going to be referring people on our website to some of their studies, because Seventh-day Adventists, one is they have some excellent studies dealing with the dates and the chronology and scholarly stuff that people can look at. But, you know, I know Ron Dupree's opposed the 25-20, but not very strongly.
That's correct. He would say it's not his specialty. He don't know much about it. He knows more about feast days and all the other stuff, but he doesn't really, you know, come strongly, because he would say, you know what, they ask him just to tie in, you know, to, you know, and when they do the other, his other presentation, just to mention the 25-20, you know, so if one is bad, that means all has to be bad. But he doesn't really come hard against it, because as he would say, I can't, you know, I don't know enough about it to oppose it strongly.
Yeah, when I visited with him, he just said he just doesn't know enough to even to begin to look at it. He doesn't know enough about chronology. So, you know, he just said your knowledge is way beyond my knowledge on any of this stuff, so I couldn't possibly begin to to challenge it, you know, other than he repeats some weak arguments that other people have used, which he knows does not apply to what we teach. So he knows that we're not teaching what other people are teaching regarding Leviticus 26, that we have a different way of understanding it. So he knows that. So he just says he's not even really opposing what we're teaching. He's just opposing the sort of general view that a lot of different groups have. But anyway, so if there's no other questions, we can close with prayer. Okay. Dear Father in heaven, we are so thankful for the Sabbath and for your truth and for the rest that we find in Christ. And we pray for your church, the Seventh-day Adventist Church, its members all over the world, and especially for those that are sighing and crying for the abominations that are done in the land, that are seeking to see the sins in their own lives and to follow you fully, to confess those sins and to be changed and be converted. And we ask, Lord, that we can have that type of heart, that we can see our need of you. Pray for each person that's been following the meetings here today. And we ask, Lord, that you can bless each one of them, their families, their particular situations, whether they're affected by the lockdowns that are coming. And help us, Lord, in making a decision in how we're going to live our life as we go forward. We know, Lord, that you are, in a sense, forcing us to face some things that many of us have not wanted to face, where we live and what we're doing with our time. And so we ask, Lord, that you can continue to work upon our hearts, to convict us of our sins, and to be a witness to those that we know that we come in contact with each day. Thank you again for the Sabbath and for the fellowship. And we pray and thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
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 Thanks
very much, Theodore.
You're welcome.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, Theodore. Thank you, Jean. And thank you, Janice, for all your work.
Thanks, Theodore.
Thank you.